Morning, church family. Pastor Colin checking in. I'm heading to my second favorite place in the world, Easton Bible Church. You know, as I pull into the church, I see those who teach and disciple. I see all those who gathered here before me for generations, for years past. They worshiped here, rejoiced here, and yes, they went through struggles here together as one body, as one family. Can you imagine how many prayers went up from this place? They've gone up to the King of Kings, the one we worship here today. It brings a smile to my face that I can be a part of this legacy. I'm challenged and excited that we, the church family, here and now, can be a part of this rich history of Easton.
How we all doing? Everybody get to the beach yet? Okay, if you answered, then you're not at the beach, and so obviously there are people at the beach. Well, good to see you guys. Psalm 148, what a wonderful psalm. This is a psalm that talks about the Lord inviting all of creation, that includes you and I, to praise him. So I'm going to read this for you, and then we'll stand and sing together. It says, praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens and you waters above the skies. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for at his command they are created, and he established them forever and ever. Hey, let's stand as we learn a new song together, okay? Let's try this.
Upon his face, the ageless one in time's embrace. Christ shall reign upon the earth. The bitter wars that rage are birth pains of a coming age. When he renews the land and sky, all heaven will sing and earth reply with one resplendent theme, the glory of our God and King.
Truth and the life, and we sing to him this morning.
Through every battle, through every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress. You are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. Provider, you are protector, you are the one I love. I believe you are the way,
come on,
the truth, the life. I believe you are.
Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Come on, let's continue to sing together.
It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to. Because they can't stay long when I'm here with you.
It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to. Because they can't stay long when I believe that you are. The life, I believe that you are the way, the truth, and the life, I believe that you are, it's a new
because they can't stay long when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life.
Our hearts to you now, Lord. We look to you, the author, the finisher of our faith. Father, thank you that you are so good to us, so merciful, and so holy, set apart. God, we worship you in spirit and in truth. But Lord, we know that you are the way, the truth, the life, that you are the one that gives us hope, the one that gives us life, the one that gives us direction, but the one that gives us salvation. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Let's lift our voices together.
new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery, yeah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
God, thank you for your holiness. Thank you for who you are, Lord. And we aspire to be holy as well, Lord. Father, forgive us of our sins. Cleanse us now within. And we ask that we would be ready to hear your word now, to hear what you put on your servant's heart. Father, thank you again for this time. We lift you up. You are the reason that we are here. And we all said together, amen. You may be seated.
Well, Jeff, it's so good to be with you. Share with the church how long you guys have been serving in the Philippines.
Well, we've been serving in the Philippines since 1996. Philippines is actually our second field. We were in Indonesia from 89 to 96.
What kind of led you, I guess, to the Philippines then?
Actually, we were kind of content in Indonesia and in the teaching ministry and church planning ministry. Mm-hmm. But we ran into visa trouble, and God directed us through a number of different circumstances to the Philippines, mainly because the school there had a similar practical emphasis that the school in Indonesia had. And so that's why we considered going to the Philippines and going to the International Graduate School of Leadership.
So through much prayer, I'm sure God led
it was tough to leave Indonesia.
Well, I do know from my brother-in-law and his being missionary in Philippines that some of the food can be quite interesting. So is there a food maybe that you could recommend with us or share? Maybe is your favorite food, yours and Jerry's food in the Philippines?
Probably the most interesting food I had in the Philippines was on a ministry week. And the family that was hosting us served us octopus in black ink.
Okay.
And we're all eating this octopus, and I'm looking at the rest of our team, and everybody's lips are turning black, and their teeth are black, and
kind of like a blue raspberry popsicle, same kind of effect, but it's squid.
It was pretty hard to not chuckle while we're eating, because we know these folks had given us their best. This is one of their favorite meals.
Right. But
I've never eaten anything quite like that before.
Yeah. I guess if you could share with the church kind of what your main responsibility is there, what you kind of do on a day-to-day.
Well, it's changed over the years. I've been in the Bible department since the beginning, mainly teaching Old Testament courses. I guess one of my favorites is teaching the Geography of Bible Lands class, which I was there in 82, 83, and that's where I met my wife to be there. And so a lot of fond memories from living in Israel. I've taught various classes, Hebrew, books of the Bible from the Old Testament, even some New Testament classes. And a little bit later on, I became the chairman of the Biblical Studies Department. And most recently, I've been asked to be the executive director of the school, which means I'm in charge of the day-to-day operations of the school. Fortunately, I don't have to do the fundraising. That's our president's job.
Good.
But pretty much the day-to-day stuff is my responsibility.
What do you enjoy most, I guess, about your role there?
I think like most faculty at our school, we enjoy most the students. Mm. God gives us quality students from all over Asia. We get to rub shoulders with them in the classroom, in small groups. We do ministry together. We have small mentoring groups. We meet once a week with them. And we get to know them, their families, and that's really the highlight.
Just building those relationships.
Yeah.
And what would you say is your big challenges, I guess, that you and Jerry really had to seek the Lord's guidance and will on?
Just the day-to-day of trying to teach the Bible to students from sometimes up to 25 different countries with their different cultures, different backgrounds, trying not to be culturally biased myself and the way I approach the scriptures, and trying to do in a way that's culturally relevant for them. That's a challenge.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So you'll be sharing a message with us this weekend. You want to just give us a little kind of glimpse into what you'll be sharing with us?
All right. Well, I'll be talking about the God of the unexpected, and I'm going to be tying that to our ministry over the past year or so and how God has done some amazing things, totally unexpected things in the midst of COVID that we had no idea he was going to do.
In the midst of another unexpected thing,
yeah.
Right? He threw a couple more your way. I always enjoy when you and Jerry are home, enjoy your company. We've done a lot of things. We just actually had a nice bike ride the other day with Rob Hoffman and I. So. Just enjoy your here. Appreciate all that you guys are doing in the Philippines, and look forward to hearing your message this weekend. So God bless you, brother.
Thanks, Colin. Appreciate your friendship and reaching out to us when we're home.
There's a church in the valley by the wildwood. No lovelier place in the dale. No spot is so dear to my childhood as the little brown church in the vale.
Well, good morning. Yeah. You know, that octopus really was quite good, but it was hard to not smile when you looked at the others around the table with their teeth and their tongues turning black. But I bring greetings from the Philippines, from our brothers and sisters there, and from the 25 nations that are represented at the International Graduate School of Leadership. It's been good worshiping with you these past 2.5 months as we've been in the States. And we think about 100 years at Easton. I began thinking, I started coming to Easton in 1976, so that's 45 years. That's almost half of the 100 years. That's making me feel old. But I first started coming to Easton when I was a college student. My roommate in college in my sophomore year was Mike Hughes, and his mom, Anita Hughes, went to this church, and Bob started coming a little bit later. And so that's how I found out about Easton way back in 1976. And I remember Pastor Ted Trump, I was the pastor at the time. My Sunday school teacher was Frank Owen. And he was also my boss. One summer I worked at his orchard over there in Marlton, picking apples and peaches and things like that. And Frank Jr. and Jim Smith Jr. Were in my discipleship group at that time. So, fond memories of many years here at Easton, and just want to thank you for the part that you have played in praying for us and supporting us, even back when I was single, working on Louisiana State University campus, and then in Indonesia, and most recently in the Philippines. So this morning, we're going to be looking at a message I've entitled, God of the Unexpected, from 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 to 14. Our God is an amazing God. His ways are above our ways. His thoughts are above our thoughts. And he does things that we couldn't even think or imagine. And he's done that over the past year and a half during this pandemic at our school in the Philippines. And we're going to look at a passage where he did some quite unexpected things. So let's turn to 2 Kings 5, 1 through 14. I'm going to read that passage. Now Naaman, captain of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man with his master and highly respected, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man was also a valiant warrior, but he was a leper. Now the Arameans had gone out in bands and had taken captive a little girl from the land of Israel, and she waited on Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "I wish that my master were with the prophet who is in Samaria. Then he would cure him of his leprosy." Naaman went in and told his master, saying, "Thus and thus spoke the girl who is from the land of Israel." Then the king of Aram said, "Go now, I will send a letter to the king of Israel." He departed and took with him 10 talents of silver and 6,000 shekels of gold and 10 changes of clothes. He brought the letter to the king of Israel, saying, "And now as this letter comes to you, behold, I have sent Naaman, my servant, to you, that you may cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man is sending word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? But consider now and see how he is seeking a quarrel against me." It happened when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, that he sent word to the king saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Now let him come to me, and he shall know that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and his chariots and stood at the doorway of the house of Elisha. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh will be restored to you, and you will be clean." But Naaman was furious and went away and said, "Behold, I thought he would surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leper. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" So he turned and went away in a rage. Then his servants came near and spoke to him and said, "My father, had not the prophet told you to do some great thing, would you not have done it? How much more then when he says to you, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. And his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for that you are an amazing God. You do far beyond what we could even imagine or think. And Lord, we thank you that you've continued to work even in the midst of the pandemic and shown yourself alive and mighty, and we thank you that you surprise us. We can never figure you out. You are so amazing. So guide us as we go through your scripture this morning and hear about also what you've been doing in Asia through IGSL. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we see a lot of unexpected things in this passage. In the first verse, we see that Naaman was a non-Israelite, yet he was being helped by the Lord. So here's this foreigner being helped by the Lord in battle, and some of those battles were against Israel itself. So God is reaching out to a foreigner, to a Gentile. Also in verse 1, we see Naaman is a great man, respected, a mighty warrior. Yet, and the unexpected part is, he was a leper. Now, the word for leper in the Old Testament is a word that covers various skin diseases. It's not necessarily what we associate with leprosy today, that is Hansen's disease. And probably Naaman didn't have Hansen's disease because he continued working. People weren't fearful of catching what he had. So probably he didn't have Hansen's disease, but he had some type of skin disease, which the Bible uses that broad term of leprosy. In verses 2 to 4, we see the word of wisdom comes from a very unexpected source, a lowly, captive servant girl gives advice to this high, mighty warrior. You know, the Arameans had come into the land on one of their raids, had captured this little girl, hauled her off to Syria, and she became the servant girl of Naaman's wife. So what a contrast between this lowly servant girl and this great warrior. But God was using Aram to discipline Israel at this time. Israel was faithless. They were into apostasy, idolatry. 2 Kings chapter 13, verse 3 says, a few chapters farther along, God gave them continually into the hand of Hazael, king of Aram. So God was giving his people, Israel, into the hand of Aram at this time because of their unfaithfulness. So we see this little girl gives this mighty warrior advice. In verses 5 and 6, the king of Aram sends a letter and a gift to the king of Israel. Now, that wasn't too unusual because back in those days, people would seek out the help of a prophet, especially one who could heal. Sometimes they would offer money to get these services. Think back in the book of Numbers with Balak and Balaam. Okay, so that part wasn't that unusual, but the gift was enormous. It was 10 talents of silver, that's 700 pounds, 6,000 shekels of gold. That's 150 pounds. Okay, usually we measure gold in grams. This is 150 pounds. So it was a huge, huge gift. But it didn't accomplish the expected result. It really accomplished nothing. The letter and the gifts accomplished nothing because God nor his prophet could be bought in this way. Well, in verse 7, the king of Israel thinks that he is expected to heal Naaman. He thinks the king of Aram is just trying to pick a fight with him and start a war. This king, probably King Joram, is a man of no faith. He doesn't even think, oh, I'll go to the Lord about this, or I'll go talk to Elisha about this. He just says, what am I to do? I can't do this. And so he just looked to himself. He had no faith at all. In verse 8 is one of the expected things in this passage, and that is Elisha wanted God to get the glory. He wanted Naaman and the king of Aram to know that the true God was in Israel and that he was his prophet. Jesus comments on the days of Elisha and says that no Israelite leper was healed at that time. That's in Luke 4:27. So King Joram was a man of no faith. The people were in the midst of apostasy and idolatry. So there was no healing going on in Israel. So God reaches out to this foreign nation and heals this man, Naaman. In verses 9 to 10, we see when Naaman arrived with his horses and his chariots, Elisha doesn't even come out to greet him. Here comes this general with horses, chariots, a huge, huge gift. And Elisha doesn't even come out. He sends his servant out with a message. And Naaman, I'm sure, felt kind of snubbed at this point. He was a general. He came with this great retinue of people, and he was probably resistant at this point, doubtful. What's going on here? He expected a better river in verse 12. He says, the rivers in my hometown are better than this muddy Jordan. Why should I do that? In verse 13, he gets advice from another unlikely source, his servants. They say to him, "Do what the prophet says." And so he humbles himself, even though he was expecting something great. He humbles himself and goes and washes in the Jordan. And in verse 14, we see that God does an amazing thing. His flesh is restored, but not just back to normal. It's better than normal. It's the flesh like a little child. And you think of a baby or a young child's skin. It's just so soft and smooth. And God restores Naaman's skin to better than normal. And so what's the response of Naaman? We see in verse 15. When he returned to the man of God with all his company and came and stood before him, he said, "Behold now, I know that there is no God in all the earth but in Israel. So please take a present from your servant now." So he offers the present again. Elisha refuses, but he came to faith. He came to faith in the true God. He recognizes that the God of Israel is the true God. So this formerly proud Gentile warrior humbles himself, does what the prophet said, or the servant of the prophet, washes, and he's cleansed and genuinely converted. So all through this passage, we see that God is doing some amazing and unexpected things. And God's been doing some amazing things, I'm sure, in your lives during this pandemic, and he certainly has in the lives of us at IGSL. And so I'd like to share some of those things with you this morning. We have some slides that we'll be showing. So if we could pull those up. Well, in the middle of March 2020, the government of the Philippines decided all schools were going to be closed. The doors were shut. We didn't have any say in it. And so all of a sudden, our buildings, our classrooms were shut down for face-to-face teaching. Okay, next slide. In just 2 weeks' time, our faculty were able to get their courses online, and we even had our first graduation in May 2020. So you can see there in Zoom, of course, you only show your waist up, so you can wear your sandals or whatever. My wife thought that was funny, so she took a picture of me. But here's our graduation on Zoom. And there's a funny backstory to our conversion to online. About 3 years ago, the board of directors of our school, IGSL, said we needed to be moving towards online delivery. That's the wave of the future. We can reach in places that we can't reach now. And so we need to come up with an online program. And guess who they chose to be in charge of getting the school online 3 years ago? Okay, well, we were right in the middle of a curriculum revision. So all our faculty were busy rewriting their courses, trying to bring it up to date, make it more relevant. And so for a year, I tried working with our faculty, saying, "We need to go online. You need to start rewriting your courses to go online." "Oh, Jeff, that's a good idea. Yeah, but I'm too busy right now." "Maybe in a while we'll get to that." And so after a year's time, we basically hadn't made any progress in moving towards online teaching. And then within 2 weeks after the pandemic hit, all our faculty were teaching online. So God can do amazing things. You know, I'd struggled for over a year and got nowhere, and God did that in 2 weeks. Okay, next slide. So all our faculty needed to learn how to teach online. It's not just a matter of recording your class and putting your head on the screen. They say the average attention span of young people today is, what, 4 minutes, 5 minutes? And you can't put a 120-minute lecture on screen and expect your students to have their attention that whole time. So we had to learn how to do things differently. And so we took courses online to learn how to teach online, because there was no other way to do it. And so we took courses at the ICETE Academy. Okay, next slide. Well, our strategy at IGSL in terms of ministry is the Win, Build, Send strategy. Campus Crusade adopted that strategy back in the early 50s. I'm pretty sure they borrowed it from another individual by the name of Jesus, who had been using that same strategy of winning people to Christ, building them up in the faith, discipling them, and then sending them out to reach others. And so all our students are involved in ministry, but how do you do ministry when you can't meet anybody face to face? So we were challenged with, how are we going to do this? And so we had to retool in this area as well, figure out how can we reach out. Okay, next slide. Well, it was mainly through social media and online. We saw 534 people won to Christ through our students this past year. And we praise God for that. Next slide. This is a quote from one of our students, Argel. She's married to a military man. And a few years back, God opened the doors at our school to have an inroad into the armed forces of the Philippines. We signed a memorandum of agreement, and they agreed to let their people come study at our school for 2 years to get a Master's of Arts in Transformational Leadership. And so we've been blessed having these Armed Forces people at our school, and they take our courses. Actually, some of them even become believers through coming to our school. Not all of them were believers coming in, and now they're having ministries in the Air Force, in the Army, Navy, Coast Guard, in firefighters, police, and prison systems. So we have about four or five families every year that the government sends to our school. So one family is Argel and her husband Joshua, and this is what she said. The vast array of social media platforms available as tools to connect have allowed me to exceed my target, even with little time on my hands. We had three events with over 100 people in attendance and close to 30 who accepted the gospel. So through her web, her net of friends and contacts on social media, she was able to reach out. Okay, next slide. This is from Jamie Young, the wife of a pastor. She said this, God moved in our church leaders' hearts, and they were very receptive when we shared about multiplying disciples. Within 1 week, two of our leaders shared the gospel with six people. Now God is moving the church to become a disciple-making church.
Good day, everyone. My name is Major Mean Esminas of the Philippine Air Force, and I just recently graduated from the MA in Transformational Leadership Program at IGSL. I would like to thank the Board of Trustees for their oversight over the school, which has been God's instrument of transformation for me and my family. More than being a military officer, I now have a deeper appreciation of my design as a helpmeet to my husband and a mother to our four-year-old son named Caspian. Our living God shepherded our family from a season of trials and pains and led us to IGSL, which we consider our still waters and green pastures that God used to restore our souls. We are truly thankful for our IGSL faculty and staff, both for Leo's Foundations of Christian Leadership classes and for me, for my degree program and my partners in ministry program. For they have been truly channels of God's transformative work in our heads, hearts, and hands. I thank God for the work that went through the new curriculum and its administration, allowed me to grow in the disciplines of biblical studies, education, theology, contextualization, and leadership, which together with the TAM and the ISG brought me to a holistic learning experience that allowed us to finish beyond borders. For now, as we await our assignment, my assignment in the Air Force, we continue to seek God's work in our hearts and in our lives, as we continue to grow in following Jesus, and we also seek to share the good news to our family, friends, and colleagues. Well, this chart is a testament of God's work in us and through us, that our responsibility is to share His goodness, relying on the power of the Holy Spirit. And we also continue to minister to a group of 15 young officers here in Lipa Air Base. We started last July with an all-female group of five, and the transformed lives of these ladies has been used by God to draw more people to our group that has now grown to 15 persons. And lastly, last June 1, 3 days after graduation, God graciously allowed me the opportunity to put into actual use my IGSL learnings. The commander of the Air Force unit concerned with managing air operations in the Northern Luzon, a general, a person of peace from God, requested for to design and facilitate a training that will enable his personnel to grow in the disciplines of self-leadership. It was truly an exercise of God dependence on my part at so many levels. Because it was my first time to do an online webinar of this design and scale. And foremost, on the third day, my audience were 28 officers, 12 of whom were my seniors. One brigadier general, one full colonel, 5 lieutenant colonels, and 4 majors. But God assured me that it was from God's authority that I'm facilitating this webinar. More than being able to give back to the Air Force, which generously allowed me to go to my IGSL schooling, I praise God too that although that was a secular training, 180 people were exposed to the gospel. Praise God indeed for that. And as we trust that God is walking ahead of us, we are assured that God's work in us and through us will continue. Praise God again for our still waters and our green pastures, the IGSL. To God be all the glory.
Okay, so that's one of our students, Mayan. All right, next slide. Well, in terms of build, we saw 57 follow-up groups get started and 33 what we call go viral groups. Next slide. We borrowed that strategy from one of the large churches in the Philippines, Christ Commission Fellowship, which is actually the church that Jerry and I attend in the Philippines. And they have a strategy, very simple strategy of prayer, care, share. So you start out, you pray for your group of friends, and then you care for them, maybe connect with them online, maybe ask how they could be prayed for, and then as God opens up opportunities to share, you do that. And so they've seen a lot of things happen through this. I don't know if you noticed in Mayan's video that we call it a spider chart of all those lines going out from her, and those are her contacts who have reached other contacts who have reached other contacts. And that has just gone viral in many ways, where many people have been reached. Okay, next slide. Well, I'd like to have Jerry come on up and share a little bit about her ministry at this point. So, Jerry. This mic.
Hi, good morning. yeah, it's wonderful to be with you here today and share what God's been doing, especially in this since the pandemic. As the doors have been closed physically to our campus, God has opened wide the doors to many, many, many other places. And just a few of the things that I've been able to do, had the privilege to do, is I've been part of this children's ministry movement throughout the world, and it's called One for 50. And usually they do trainings for children's leaders and things like that. And one of the pushes they had during the pandemic was to create videos to help train children's leaders and the church. And so one of the videos that I was able to do was this one called The Family and the Church as a Team. And they write the scripts. They just wanted some different faces to present these things to help equip church leaders. Next slide, please. Another responsibility I had at IGSL, they asked me to lead the prayer movement last school year. And as in any ministry, prayer is really the foundation to a ministry, and I'm glad that I had that privilege to lead it last year, especially with Jeff changing into his new role. But what we did once a week on Zoom, we had just a one-hour opportunity for people to come online, the students or staff or faculty to come online and pray together for the needs of the world, the church, the school, and us personally. And then we also did a weekly SoundCloud devotional scripture lectio divina, those of you that know that type of reflection in scripture and prayer. We had that once a week. And also we sent a text to all the students just to let them know we were praying for them and a portion of scripture to pray over them. So that was one. That was part of my ministry last year. Next slide, please. And then a really wonderful opportunity opened up last year as well. Well, for the past 3 years, I've been involved in helping our school at IGSL to develop a child safety policy for our school, because all the when the families come from all these different countries, they bring their families. It's not just if they're married, they bring their whole families. And so we have a campus full of maybe about 90 children, of which we help school and have this wonderful community of families. But we also needed to provide some child safety protocols on campus, just in any school or community. So I've been working on that, leading that for the school. And then this past year, with everything shut down and families going home, the Lord opened up this opportunity to host a webinar for Christian leaders, church leaders, on the topic of protecting children from abuse in your ministry. Unfortunately, this type of thing, abuse, can happen inside churches, inside Christian ministries, inside Christian schools, and it does happen, and Christian leaders need to be aware of that. The church needs to be aware of that. And so this was a webinar that I hosted along with the expert, Ms. Rhea, who was our trainer for developing our child safety program policy at IGSL. So that was a wonderful opportunity to do that and to reach many Christian leaders. And then, next slide, please. And then the follow-up, that's part of the webinar. And then the next slide, please. The follow-up to that was to offer a nano course, a mini course, for those leaders that wanted to be further trained in how to help their communities or their churches or their schools to be more aware of the child safety issues. And so we had a several-week course on that. And those people have in turn shared with their churches or their schools about more child awareness, about child abuse, and how to respond, prevent and respond properly. Mm-hmm. Okay, next slide, please.
Okay, well, I have a mic here somewhere. One of the ministries that our students have or do is in the summer, and some of the students wanted to go, this is pre-pandemic, wanted to go to Mongolia and minister there. But the doors kind of closed for that, although things are a little bit more open out in the provinces of Mongolia. So our students decided that they would train a group of young people, youth, at a church called Transformational Church in Mongolia. We've had about four families from Mongolia come to our school recently. And so they want to train the youth of this church to reach out to the nomadic people of Mongolia in areas where there are a little bit more freedom than in the cities because of COVID. Next slide. And so there's Mongolia there above, north of China. Huge place. Okay, next slide. And one of the young men in my discipleship group, all our faculty have what we call an iron sharpening group. And Rock Lee It was one of my students, and he's on this team to reach out to Mongolia. So they've been communicating with the youth there several times a week, training them and preparing them to reach out to these nomadic people of Mongolia. Okay, next slide. Send. So we've seen newly trained disciples. They've shared the gospel with 57 people. So these new converts have been won to Christ, built up, and then they in turn are reaching out to others. Next slide. Chawit from Thailand said this: when COVID hit, my plan to make disciples at a local university came to a screeching halt. But through Go Viral, I learned how to make disciples online. I began the group with only one person. Then it became two, then three, and now there are four. One guy has started to share the gospel already. So somebody in his group is now turning around and sharing the gospel with others. Okay, next slide. So that's our strategy in terms of ministry for our students. We've had to move that to an online format, but we praise God for the creative ways that our faculty and staff have been able to do that. Next slide. As you saw in the brief introduction, at our most recent graduation, we were honored with being recognized as having served at IGSL for 25 years, so we praise God for that. Next slide. And I have a new role at the school as executive director, which means I'm in charge of the day-to-day operations of the school. I have to care for our faculty spiritually, emotionally, make sure they're doing well, and make sure that our school is on target with our mission and vision. So that's my job. It's been a huge challenge. I think it would have been a huge challenge with no COVID, but with COVID, it certainly was a challenge. Every day was new things, new questions. Hadn't thought about that. Oh, what about if this person gets COVID and then this happens and then, oh, I hadn't thought about that. So that's kind of how it's been this whole past year and a half of it's been certainly a challenge, but God has been there each step of the way, and we have a very good leadership team that I work with. Okay, next slide. Okay, our family. Just give you a quick update on our family. Jerry, you want to bring a little update?
Yes. We just want to update real quickly about our family. Thank you for those of you that pray for our family. We'll go from oldest to youngest, and many of you know our kids when they were this little, but now they're not. Yeah. They're adults now. So Daniel, this is our son Daniel, and he's in Oakland, California. That's his dog, Paws. And he's working in software tech sales. In Oakland. okay, next slide, please. Steven, our second, he's living in Hong Kong. Actually, was here in the States for 2 weeks, and he just arrived back yesterday. And he's a teacher, he's a physics teacher, I was telling Abigail this morning, that he's a physics teacher at a British international school in Hong Kong, and really loves it there. And then Chris, our next slide, please. I'm so grateful for many of you who come up to me every week. You come up and ask, how's Chris? He's the one that has undergone his cancer, has undergone chemo this last year. He finished his last chemo the end of March. We came home in February to help him through his second and third cycle. And he went through another surgery June 8th, and he's doing well, and the doctor thinks he is clear, and so we praise God for that. Thank you for praying for him. Actually, all the kids were here on July 4th. They were here in church, and Chris and his new wife, Chris was married April 24th, this is his new wife, Ashley. They were all here to visit to pay respects to my mom who passed away. Thank you for those that have prayed for us and acknowledging that this morning. Thank you for that. But thank you for your prayers for our family. Chris is a social worker in Los Angeles, working with troubled youth in Los Angeles.
Okay, that's pretty much it. I would like to open it up for a few questions. I don't know how we're doing on time. I don't even know when things usually finish. I don't see a stop flashing in the back. But I guess there'll be a big hook here anytime now. But maybe we could open up for a question or two about...
What's the dog's name?
Oh, the dog's name. Pause. Very original. Pause. P-A-W-S. Okay. Other questions? How many languages do I speak? Not enough, that's for sure. Fortunately, even though we have students coming from 25 different countries, we do all our instruction in English. So I can speak English, and I speak a little Indonesian and a little, very little, Tagalog. I had to learn Hebrew and Greek, but languages aren't my forte, and so fortunately for me, we teach in English, but that's hard for our students because they're doing theological education in the second language. But it does open up doors because once they get their English polished, it opens up a whole world of English Bible study tools that are now open to them. So it really works to their advantage to struggle through English. It's a hard language, but yeah, it does open up doors. Other questions? Maybe one or two. Where I grew up. Okay. Well, I won't go all the way back to the beginning, but I grew up in Medford Lakes since fourth grade and went to Shawnee High School and went to University of Florida. That's where I came to know the Lord. That was kind of ironic at that school, but God had his ways there. And then ministry at Louisiana State University, and then off to the mission field. Jerry?
Yes. Yeah, I was born and raised in Atlantic City. Those of you who are interested, I'm an ABC, American-born Chinese. So yeah, I went to Atlantic City High School, went to college at Cedarville University. It was Cedarville College then. And my third year at Cedarville, I went to Israel to study, and that's where I met Jeff. And,
yeah. Yep.
Jeff, was it love at first sight?
We got to be good friends there.
Good question.
All right, I'm going to give you a short answer here. We're 5.5 years apart, and at that point in my life, having been through some long-distance relationships, I wasn't thinking of another one. So at first, I wasn't thinking in that direction, but I knew she was very special. And when I got down to Dallas at Dallas Seminary, flipping my Greek cards and, you know, trying to learn Greek, and I'm thinking to myself, boy, I think I let a good one get away here. So we started communicating by letter and cassette tapes. Anybody remember cassette tapes? Okay, because phone calls back then weren't free. They were $1 a minute long distance. And so you didn't stay on the phone for a long time. So that's how we kind of dated early on. And then Jerry moved down after she graduated. Okay. All right, well, we better stop there. Thank you so much for your involvement in our lives, your prayers. This church has faithfully supported us and prayed for us. And we just are so thankful for that. Let me pray. Father, we thank you for this body of believers, how they've encouraged us over the years and stood faithfully with us. And Lord, we thank you for the part that they have had in training Christians in Asia to reach Asians. And Lord, we pray that you would continue to use this church in a mighty way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Jeff and Jerry, so much. It's so good to see you guys here every Sunday worshiping with us. We thought it would be kind of fun to do something. We're going to try this. But it's a song you all know very well. It's Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus. But we thought it would be fun to actually learn it in Tagalog, which is the Filipino language. And we happen to have somebody on our worship team
that is Filipino. So there you go. No pressure, Ruth.
It's all good.
None at all. But
we
thought it would be kind of fun if we stand and we sing one of these verses in English, and then we'll try to learn it together a couple times in Tagalog. Listen and we'll learn it together. Father, we thank you for this time, Lord. We thank you that your word reaches across this globe, Lord. Lord, sometimes we think we're a silo here and that we're the only ones worshiping you. But God, as we sang this morning, all creation cries out to you, Lord, and we just join with it. And we join with all those around the world that are worshiping you as well and bringing you praise and calling you our Savior. So, Father, we thank you for this time. Continue to bless the people of the Philippines. Continue to bless Jeff and Jerry in their ministry. And we thank you again for all of your blessings here. And we ask your blessing now in our day. In Jesus' wonderful name, we all say, amen. God bless you guys. Have a wonderful week in Jesus.